Tonight, a very special show. We take you to New Orleans 10 years after Hurricane Katrina. We'll expose the rebirth and the challenges facing the Crescent City. My exclusive interviews with U.S. Senator David VITTER of Louisiana, New Orleans Mayor MITCH LANDRIEU, and Archbishop of New Orleans Gregory Amond, and many more. Later, Donald Trump continues to widen his lead over his GOP competitors for president. What is the reason for his ascension? And will it slow anytime soon? Editor-in-Chief of CNS News, Terry Jeffrey, joins us to discuss. The World Over Live begins right now.
Now, from Washington, D.C., Raymond Arroyo.
A warm welcome to all of you joining us in the United States and the world over. Senator David VITTER, Mayor MITCH LANDRIEU, Archbishop Gregory Amond, Ann Milling, and Terry Jeffrey are all straight ahead. If you'd like to comment on tonight's show, or if you have a question, I'll be live tweeting throughout. It's a very special program. Find me on Twitter at Raymond Arroyo, or you can email me at worldover@EWTN.com. Here's the brief news from the world over this week. Friends, colleagues, and all of America are mourning the deaths of television journalists Allison Parker and Adam Ward in Roanoke, Virginia. The two were gunned down by a former colleague on live television. The gunman was Vester Flanagan, who later shot himself. In a 23-page letter sent to ABC News, Flanagan confessed to the Wednesday murders. He wrote that it was his intent to provoke a race war and that it was the Charleston church shooting of black congregants back in June that, quote, sent me over the top. Flanagan then launched into an expletive-laced racist tirade against the South Carolina shooter. He further saw himself as a victim, claiming he had suffered racial discrimination, sexual harassment, and bullying at work. He claimed to have been, quote, attacked for being a gay black man, end quote. The White House, Virginia Governor Terry McAuliffe, and presidential candidate Hillary Clinton all suggested that the murders underscore the need for gun control legislation. President Obama said this to an ABC affiliate in Philadelphia.
What we know is that the number of people who die from gun-related incidents around this country dwarfs any deaths that happen through terrorism.
And President Obama visited New Orleans this week to mark the 10th anniversary of Hurricane Katrina. His first stop, Treme, one of the oldest black neighborhoods in America. The president walked from house to house greeting residents and extolled the progress that's been made in the decade since the storm nearly destroyed the Crescent City.
Because of you, the people of New Orleans, working together, this city is moving in the right direction. And I have never been more confident that together we will get to where we need to go.
This marked the president's 9th visit to New Orleans. He also dropped in on Katrina's 5th anniversary in 2010. We have much more on the 10th anniversary of Katrina and my special report later in the show. And in Iraq, at least a dozen people, including two Iraqi generals, were killed in ISIS bombings this week. New reports indicate ISIS's apparent willingness to use chemical weapons. Experts in Syria are confirming the likely use of mustard gas on civilians there. After an attack near Aleppo this past Friday, more than 50 people began suffering from respiratory problems, skin burns, and eye irritation, consistent with exposure to the chemical agent. According to British intelligence, ISIS is now capable of manufacturing chemical weapons. Another historic site of antiquity has been destroyed by ISIS in Syria. The jihadist militants blew up the 2nd-century Baal Shamin Temple in the old city of Palmyra this week. The blast was so powerful it damaged some of the Roman columns that surround the ancient temple. ISIS also beheaded Khalid al-Assad, an 80-year-old scholar and archaeologist. He headed Palmyra's antiquities department for more than half a century. Meanwhile, near Homs, the Islamic State bulldozed the 5th-century St. Ilion Monastery. The monastery housed the tomb of the 3rd century martyr for which it is named. Monastery priest Father Jacques Mourad was kidnapped from the area in May. He remains missing. ISIS captured the city earlier this month. 200 local residents, many of them Christians, were also abducted. Most of their fates remain unknown. And in Damascus, 2 Catholic churches were hit in mortar attacks on Sunday, including the Church of Maronite Catholic Archbishop Shamir Nassar. Fides News reports that 50 were injured and an unspecified number of people killed. The archbishop said that living with the indiscriminate bombings of the Syrian war is a kind of Russian roulette, which is always unpredictable. Another damning undercover Planned Parenthood video was released by the Center for Medical Progress this week. In it, the head of a tissue procurement company, which partnered with Planned Parenthood, alleges that the abortion provider supplies, quote, a lot of intact bodies of aborted babies, describing them as a volume institution. Kate Dyer, CEO of Stem Express, says that her company has a heavy demand for fetal tissue, which Planned Parenthood clinics provide. At one point, Dyer laughs as she talks about the lab technicians who, quote, freak out and have meltdowns when they see intact bodies of aborted babies. Stem Express ended its relationship with Planned Parenthood last week due to the ongoing exposé. And President Barack Obama is not backing down in his apparent support for Planned Parenthood. The federal government this week pulled $370,000 of health care funding from the state of Kansas. This after the state won its 3-year legal fight to defund Planned Parenthood. The 2011 law diverted $300,000 of federal family planning money away from 2 Planned Parenthood clinics. They gave the funds to other full-service health clinics. Additionally, another $300,000 was made available for pregnancy support and adoption counseling. Meanwhile, in Louisiana, on Tuesday, Planned Parenthood asked a federal court to block that state's efforts to defund its clinics. Earlier this month, Republican Governor Bobby Jindal announced plans to suspend Louisiana's contract with the abortion provider, stemming from these ongoing undercover videos. And the Little Sisters of the Poor have received a temporary reprieve from the federal contraception sterilization mandate in Obamacare. The 10th Circuit Court of Appeals in Colorado ruled that the sisters will not be subject to the Affordable Care Act's requirements or the crippling fines it could face for noncompliance. This latest court order will remain in effect until the Supreme Court decides if it will take up the nuns' appeals. If the High Court hears the case, the exemption will protect the Little Sisters until a final ruling. And the threat of an ACLU lawsuit appears to be compelling a Catholic hospital in Northern California to perform a woman's sterilization procedure. Mercy Medical Center of Redding decided that the patient can be given a tubal ligation following the birth of her baby later next month, even though the procedure would violate church teaching. The ACLU is charging that the hospital would be discriminating against the woman by denying her pregnancy-related care in choosing church doctrine over the patient's health. The patient in question is a 32-year-old attorney who says the hospital's refusal to operate would force her to travel 160 miles for the sterilization. A spokesman for the hospital said that their decision would not affect any of its future policies and that they would continue to abide by the ethical and religious directives issued by the U.S. Catholic bishops. We'll keep you posted on this one. And more than 500,000 people, including 5 cardinals and 117 bishops, have signed a petition asking Pope Francis to reinforce church teaching on marriage and the family at the upcoming Synod on the Family in October. The petition was launched earlier this year by the Catholic student group TFP Student Action. The petition asked the Pope to clear up the moral confusion that's been spreading against natural and divine law. The petition will be hand-delivered to the Vatican just ahead of the Synod on September 29th. And Cardinal William Levada, once the head of the Vatican Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith, was arrested in Hawaii for drunk driving last week. The 79-year-old former Archbishop of San Francisco was pulled over on August 20th by police on the Big Island of Hawaii. He was charged with a DUI. Levada was vacationing in Hawaii with a number of priest friends. In a statement, the cardinal said he will cooperate fully with authorities, and he expressed regret for his error in judgment. He's scheduled to appear in court next month. She has been called the fastest nun in the West. Now, some faithful hope to call her saint. Sister Blandina Segale, the Italian-born nun who challenged Billy the Kid, calmed angry mobs, and helped open New Mexico Territory hospitals and schools, has faced her first test for sainthood. On Tuesday, the Archdiocese of Santa Fe opened an inquiry into Sister Blandina's heroic virtue. Her encounters with Old West outlaws became legendary and were even the subject of an episode of the CBS series Death Valley Days. Officials caution that her canonization could take some time. Though she might be the fastest nun in the West, Rome is a bit slower on the draw when declaring sainthood. We'll follow this story as long as it takes. When we return, it's been a decade since Hurricane Katrina brought devastation to New Orleans and the Gulf Coast. We'll explore the state of the recovery, the glories and the lingering challenges. I traveled to my hometown of New Orleans, and we'll take you there on this 10th anniversary of Katrina. When we return, stay right there. Back to the world over. I'm Raymond Arroyo in the historic French Quarter. Now, the quarter was largely untouched during Katrina, but just a few blocks away, floodwater swamped 80% of this city. Now, that is a landmass equal to 8 times the size of Manhattan, just to give you some idea.
In the wake of Katrina's passing, it was an apocalyptic scene. The levees gave way, taking nearly 2,000 lives and causing upwards of $151 billion of damage.
President said, little fat man, oh, isn't it a shame what the river had done to this poor farmer's land? Oh, Louisiana, Louisiana, you're trying to wash us away. Trying to wash us away. Oh, Louisiana. Oh, 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 Louisiana. They're trying to wash us away. Oh, Lord. Trying to wash us away. They're trying to wash us away. They're trying to wash us away.
As a native New Orleanian watching my hometown, the geography of my life, literally drowned, was both traumatic and infuriating. But even in the chaos, the seeds of New Orleans' rebirth were all around. Not long after the storm, we found residents in the devastated neighborhood of Lakeview, determined to rebuild, even as their car had been relocated to the pool.
We will pick up where Hurricane Katrina left us off. And hope for the best. I'm optimistic.
All over the city, citizens began to rebuild their lives with tenacity and something more.
I mean, I don't know how anybody gets through this without faith.
10 years later, New Orleans has bounced back with her rhythm and spirit intact, as the city's mayor, MITCH LANDRIEU, was eager to share with us.
It's a great story of a comeback for an American city, a story of tragedy to triumph, a story of resurrection and redemption. A people in a city that were left for dead that found a way through the generosity of other people, you know, through grace, through just hard work and sheer character and determination to rebuild the city, not the way it was, but the way she always dreamed she could be.
There is now a brand new university hospital and med tech corridor in downtown New Orleans. graduation rates are up in the city's schools.
We took this as an opportunity not to put the schools back the way they were before, the day before Katrina hit. So we had old schools, 50 years old. And instead of taking the money and just putting plaster on the wall, we've physically rebuilt most of the schools in the city of New Orleans. So now we have 21st century learning centers. Government is working much better than it did before. And so the city is beginning to come back in a way that people, I think, never expected. As a matter of fact, you had some people that said, well, look, what's wrong with those folks down there?
Right.
You know, God visited that upon them because they're evil.
They're such bad
and
people.
And those are bad people. Mm. And they should leave. And that's until Sandy came, when we realized that it really wasn't a geographically centered.
That's right. Hurricanes hit everybody.
So I'm very happy with the recovery. It took us a while to get on our feet. The recovery was anything but a straight line. But I think in the last couple of years, you've seen the city of New Orleans is now, for the first time in 60 years, what I call an ascendant city. Forbes magazine, Wall Street Journal, everybody says it's the fastest growing city in America. People from all over the world came, and many of them stayed, so there's a new entrepreneurial spirit. All of those things have taken place. So that I think people who really haven't been paying attention because they've been busy just kind of living their daily lives would come to New Orleans, sit in amazement and say, wow, how did they do that?
Yeah.
It's a good story.
A part of that good story can be found here at the center of the French Quarter.
When Hurricane Katrina made landfall here behind the St. Louis Cathedral in the St. Anthony Garden, that iconic statue of the Sacred Heart of Jesus lost its fingers. Magnolia trees and sycamore trees thrown by the storm lobbed the fingers off. They were located by the former Archbishop Philip Hannon and members of the 82nd Airborne Division. Now, those fingers were not reattached to the statue. A decision was made to only reattach them once the city and the church had been restored. That time has now come.
Archbishop Gregory Amond of New Orleans.
My predecessor, Archbishop Hughes, said that he would leave the fingers off and not restore them as a sign of the recovery.
Uh-huh.
And though we know the recovery is not complete, mm-hmm. but it's 10 years later that we do commemorate. Mm-hmm. And so we're restoring the fingers for two reasons: to give thanks and honor to those who allowed Jesus to use their hands to help us to recover and to rebuild. Mm-hmm. Also to give thanks that God's hands have helped us to rebuild, and we're grateful mm-hmm. to God. But also to remember that for some people, they're still rebuilding.
Right.
The devastation is so great. And it's not just the physical devastation of the devastation of house or business, mm-hmm. but it's also broken hearts and sorrow and grief that some people are experiencing. Mm-hmm. Over almost 2,000 people died, yeah. their lives were taken. Mm-hmm. So in my mind, the fingers also say the work is not finished.
Mm.
And that we want Jesus to continue to use our hands and our hearts to do the final chapters that this recovery will bring about.
How has it changed this community spiritually? How has it changed the church in New Orleans? Has that Katrina experience made it a more vibrant, responsive church?
I think so, without a doubt. I think that obviously Katrina took the lives of people, mm-hmm. many buildings, an infrastructure, which yeah. we had. It's taken all of that. But as I like to say, it has not taken the faith of the people. And mm-hmm. Katrina did not take away from us perseverance. Mm. And that faith and perseverance has been very much present. And it was really the Catholic churches in many, many neighborhoods that were the first to open.
The anchor.
They were the ones, they became the anchor. They were the ones who said, God loves us, we must move on. And sometimes people ask me all the time, well, you know, where was Jesus in the midst of all this?
Right.
You know, did Jesus care? And I always image in my own mind this Jesus of love walking in the floodwaters with people in their attics as the water keeps coming up and they don't know if they're going to live, hanging on to trees, those who lost their lives. And I really see Jesus weeping, crying, very much compassionate to all that was taking mm-hmm. place. We were not abandoned. And even those who have lost loved ones, if they've lost everything, they see a God who has helped them to get through the most traumatic moment in their lives.
In fact, in the wake of the storm in 2005, former Archbishop Philip Hannon, then in his 90s, accompanied rescue teams, including the 82nd Airborne Division. He'd served with them during World War II. He embedded with these early responders, helping to secure the city and rescue her residents. Louisiana Senator David VITTER, who is running for governor.
You know, we all know the horror stories of Katrina, including stories of massive government failure, and that was all too real. But for every one of those, there was a really inspiring story of individual citizens and non-government groups, including the Catholic Church, that just stepped up in a major, major way and reached out to believers all around the country. And they flooded in and brought all sorts of people and resources. And the Catholic Church led that effort. They also led the effort in terms of being just spiritually strong and giving people hope and uplifting them in terms of their spirit. So that was really critical.
Right after the water went away, the sun came up. Like they say, joy cometh in the morning. Yeah. There was another flood, and the flood was the people of goodwill, people of faith, people of civic responsibility came into the city and said, look, it's my responsibility to help. Whether it was the young man who was actually cooking on a grill outside of Harris, who wound up on the first day feeding three people, and then before the end of the week had set up something where he was feeding 5,000 first responders. Just with contributions that came in, he came from a church in Daphne. Or a guy that I met on the corner of St. Charles Avenue and Napoleon, who was rescuing people. He was a minister from Dallas. Churches from all over the country sent people into the city. So not only was it individuals, but then institutions helped as well, and it was just a beautiful thing.
Tell me about the volunteerism we saw in the wake of Katrina. There were people from all over the United States, all over the world, who came in to help. Catholic Charities really was at the switching posts of all of this, guiding more than 60,000 volunteers in their rebuild efforts, and it goes on. Were you surprised? Were you stunned by the continuance of this?
I was stunned by it, and Catholic Charities did heroic work, and very often we forget that. Also, it was individual parishes that were trying to put together programs to invite people back. It was the individual parishes that were the first to bring the communities back. Mm. But even today, as recent as three or four weeks ago, there was a group in town from the East Coast who was here to help in any way that they could, and they specifically said, if there's anything we can do to continue to help rebuild after the Katrina incident, even though it was 10 years ago. So there are still people coming back using their hands and their hearts, thousands upon thousands of people, together with our own local people who have rebuilt this community.
Throughout the city, there is new construction. Some houses have been lifted off the ground in case of future flooding.
There are signs of rebuilding all over this city, but there is one lingering problem that predates Katrina: potholes, some 650,000 of them all over this city. And if your eye doesn't see them, your car will certainly feel them.
Your administration has identified 650,000 potholes in the city of New Orleans.
Sure.
What are you doing about it?
We had $150 billion of damage. We got reimbursed for $71 billion. Mm-hmm. We have used that limited amount of money. We've completely redone every major street in the city of New Orleans. But the interior streets, which are built on swamps, continue to deteriorate. We've filled 170,000 potholes. Massive infrastructure issue that's going to cost $9 billion. So we can't do everything all at one time.
I think our recovery in the last 10 years has been wonderful, really strong, really by any measure. The one big exception to that is violent crime in New Orleans. That's the Achilles heel. That could threaten everything. And we sure as heck didn't survive and rebuild and recover to turn our great city over to the thugs.
Crime here in New Orleans remains a real source of concern for the citizens that have come back. And it seems every day there's a murder. Every day there's two or three holdups. Yeah. It's unbelievable. Yeah. To what do you attribute that?
We need stronger leadership and more of a focus. And I've been very direct about this, including with Mayor Landrieu. You know, he's focused the last 3 months on monuments. Last I saw, the Robert E. Lee statue, who's not shot anyone, natives or tourists, in that part of the city. Leadership is about focus and priorities. We need to focus on murders, not monuments, because it is an epidemic.
Following racially motivated shootings in South Carolina, Mayor Landrieu advocated removing monuments of figures associated with the Confederacy from the streets of New Orleans. At the same time, the city's murder rate is twice the national average.
I spoke to Senator VITTER earlier about this. He says this is your leadership, that you're somehow failing and that you shouldn't be focused on monuments. Robert E. Lee never shot a tourist or a local. You would say what to him?
Well, Robert E. Lee only tried to completely disassociate this country from itself and continue to have the institution of slavery, which is the worst thing that's ever happened in the United States of America. I mean, so the issue of the Civil War and the Confederates and the monuments and how New Orleans wants to remember itself is something separate and distinct from whether or not we have crime on the streets of America. I just came from visiting Chicago, Atlanta, Houston. On the front page of every paper was an incident that happened in those cities like the one that happened in the city of New Orleans. I will say this, that the federal government in 1996 was providing, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars in police officers for cities across America. They stopped doing that. They cut the funding by 88%. Mm-hmm. But when you got to get on the front end of this, this is also about early childhood education. It's about strong families. It's about institutions that matter. And so I'm thrilled to have a partner. I'm thrilled that David wants to now work with me on reducing violence on the streets of America.
Well, his focusing on not enough federal money is sort of ironic for a couple of reasons. Number one, New Orleans has gotten more federal taxpayer help because of Katrina than any American city in history. Number two, my record of working on that and producing that is precisely the same as that of his sister, who I work with. Now, we have a very different record on other issues, but on that, it was the same, so it's pretty ironic for him to criticize that. At the state level, what I've said is I actually want to go beyond what the state police have been doing. I want to establish a whole new additional state police troop in the city of New Orleans, focused on key high priority areas like the French Quarter, but it has to be paid for with local revenue and local tourism funds. And that is possible. In fact, the city and tourism industry are working on it because it is such a desperate situation.
As a matter of fact, today, we are in the middle of a prosecution in federal court of one of the toughest gangs in the city of New Orleans who have killed people because we've been working on this for 5 years. So I tell him, welcome. And by the way, it was my suggestion that we have the state police in the quarter, and I'm thrilled that as the governor, he's going to help me get it done.
Politics aside, all parties agree that education is one of the bright lights of the New Orleans recovery. It's a charter school system which affords parents real choices in where to send their children.
This place seems to be a national model. Tell me about what's happened here with the charter schools. You only have six public schools here. Everything else is charter. Your graduations are up. Your enrollment is up. Is this a model for the rest of the country?
Most of our schools were failing and our kids were not learning. After the storm hit, it was completely unfortunate. Every building got destroyed. Everybody lost their job because the storm did that. And so we had to redesign a system. And when we did that, quite frankly, we didn't want to get into a big fight about vouchers.
Yeah.
And we didn't want to get into a big fight about public schools. We just wanted a model that worked. And we went to what's called the charter model. Now, these are public schools,
right,
but they're charter schools inside the public arena. And so what we found is that where you have not a school board that kind of oversees from the top, right, an entire system, but a school board that just manages a system of schools that have place-based authority and autonomy, where the principal has the ability to hire and fire, and they hire teachers based on grade stuff. When there's accountability of some sort for students and for teachers, where parents have some level of choice, right, in the system, it's produced a higher graduation rate, a lower dropout rate. It's produced an achievement gap that has been closed between kids in the inner city and kids outside of the city. And so it has worked better for us.
You know, the Orleans public school system was on its back, failed before Katrina. Problem is, politically, folks in New Orleans wouldn't admit it. Mm-hmm. Katrina washed that away, and everybody had to admit it because it was decimated physically as well as being failed educationally. And so it created the opportunity for all of these young people coming in, like Teach for America, for all of these charters, for choice in so many different categories of education, including voucher scholarships, including charters. So it really is a model, and it's a model I want to expand as governor. I want to expand every possible element of choice as long as we do it fairly, because choice ultimately is about empowering parents and families.
Now, it's not without its problems. We have challenges with special education. We have challenges with suspensions. We had challenges with employee-employee relationships, with teachers being let go in a way that people didn't think. So there was some hiccups to it, and there's some consternation about it. And the system is still run by the state. It's got to come back to the city. How we do that, when we do that, is all kind of part of what I call process, which should not be part of the discussion anymore, is this very simple fact. Every child has a right to a great education, and we need to provide that opportunity for them. We think we have a 21st century learning capability now, and we think that we've seen the progress.
The city has also seen progress in fortifying its flood protections. $14 billion of federal monies have been spent rebuilding levee walls, creating new pumping stations, and streamlining drainage systems. But is it enough?
We are here in the Lower Ninth Ward. We're doing the interview today. Now, this area has been rebuilt. A lot of federal dollars went into rebuilding the beautiful courthouse, the fire station, the hospital on the way in. Billions of dollars. Are you confident that this area would be able to sustain a Category 2 or 3 storm?
Well, I'm confident that our protection is far better, planets apart, from what it was the day before Katrina. I am confident of that. Will we ever have flooding again? I can't say we never will. But, you know, a key part of a good protection system is even if you get overtopping, you don't have breaches. Overtopping is one thing. Breaches is a whole other category. And where we are in St. Bernard, we had massive breaches, whole miles of levees washed away. I'm confident we're not gonna see that. The recovery here, as in New Orleans, Lower Ninth, other places, has been really, in some ways, nothing short of miraculous, but we have further to go.
Ann Milling founded a grassroots group called Women of the Storm. Milling and her group personally invited members of Congress to see New Orleans for themselves after Katrina. They continue to raise awareness today.
Well, do I feel safe? I feel safer than I did because I know all of those eye walls became T walls in the canals. I know that we have improved the pumping system and that has been enhanced tremendously. The levees have been enhanced. Is it perfect? No. Will it ever be perfect? No. And of course the wetlands, which are disappearing at the rate of one football field, every hour we lose that much of our wetlands. That's what's so frightening.
The coastal wetlands and barrier islands act as a buffer when the big storms head for the Gulf Coast. They're vanishing at an alarming rate. 200 square miles of wetlands were lost in hurricanes Katrina and Rita alone.
Every mile of wetlands cuts down storm surge, probably about a foot. So that is the first barrier that we depend on before that storm surge gets to levees and man-built barriers. So we need to turn that corner and restore wetlands. The good news is we have a plan, we're on a path to do that. Broadly speaking, there are a couple of big types of projects that are necessary. One is river diversions.
Right.
You know, before a lot of population, we didn't have levees and the river would overflow every spring and rebuild wetlands, rebuild the mouth of the river. We levied the river for obvious reasons. We had to with population, and that was necessary. But that takes all that rich nutrient material and pushes it out to the middle of the Gulf of Mexico, where it, by the way, creates a dead zone because it's so concentrated, and we aren't rebuilding land. Well, we need to artificially and in a controlled way recreate that process through diversion projects at select locations. So that's one big thing. The other big thing is we need barrier island projects. Things like that. So those are some of the key elements of the master plan.
Natural and man-made challenges await, but on this 10th anniversary of Hurricane Katrina, the people of New Orleans, the people who rebuilt their city, are looking forward to the future with a tested faith.
Yeah, it is very much lived, and it's rooted in a rich Catholic tradition. It's rooted in the victory of the Battle of New Orleans 200 years ago when the battle, Andrew Jackson, the commander, said we won't win this battle, and it was won. And not being a man of faith, he went to the Ursuline Convent and said God had something to do with this. And it was through the intercession of Our Lady of Prompt Succor And he gave into that and said, okay, this is, that kind of tradition infiltrates all that we are. But there is an understanding and an appreciation for Catholicism. Mm-hmm. And that is seen everywhere. I mean, the names of streets, you know, our counties are called parishes. They're called civil parishes. We always have to make a distinction between the civil parish and the church parish.
The church parish, right.
So there really is, and also humbly to me, you know, when I deal with other faith leaders, they will often say, we really need you to be a part of this, because they realize that the Catholic Church has a voice that's very loud, mm-hmm. that is respected, and we take that very seriously. I certainly take that very seriously mm-hmm. as a leader.
This week, Archbishop Raymond held an interreligious prayer gathering at the cathedral to give thanks for the recovery and to pray for what lies ahead.
We had Katrina, which took human life and took property and so forth, but now one of the great issues that we have in our own city is murder and violence and racism. And because of that, I have asked us as a church to recite at every Mass, every Sunday, what we call the family prayer. And it's asking God, through the intercession of Our Lady of Prompt Succor, who has helped us in times of war, disaster, epidemic, and illness, to pray with us and to pray for us that we can become a more peace-filled society. And we have to meet that challenge with faith as well.
And so the Gulf Coast and New Orleans goes on. Like some grand second line, the city is not only back on her feet, in many ways she's dancing. All the officials and the Archbishop expressed their gratitude to the millions of people around the country and the world who helped make it happen. They contributed so much in response to this unprecedented disaster. For me personally, I still can't watch the pictures of the devastation following Katrina. All of us who lived through that storm lost so much. The stuff was easily replaced, but the memories and the people that went down in those foul waters, we continue to miss them terribly. We'll keep watching the Gulf Coast and the New Orleans recovery and pray that we never see a storm like this one again. When we return, the 2016 presidential race is all Trump all the time. What is fueling his rise? Plus, why is the government creating humanized mice with fetal body parts? Terry Jeffrey of CNS News joins us to discuss all of it. The World Over Live continues in a moment. Stay there.
Now, once again, Raymond Arroyo.
Welcome back to The World Over Live. Against all the odds of campaign logic, Donald Trump continues to widen his lead over the other GOP candidates for president. On the Democratic side, there are rumblings of a Joe Biden campaign. Here to put it all in perspective, I'm joined by the editor-in-chief of CNS News, Terry Jeffrey. Terry,
hey,
thanks for joining us again.
Thanks for having me. Good
now,
to see you.
Now, let's look at this Quinnipiac poll. Just broke. Trump's at 28% among registered Republicans. His nearest competitor is Ben Carson at 12. Jeb Bush is down at 7%. To what do you attribute this? What is happening here?
Well, I think there's two things that poll very clearly indicates. One is that people in this country are fed up with the political establishment. They're fed up with the people who work in that building yeah. over there. You look at the polling numbers for them, like Trump said, it's down in single digits. Mm. They think that the professional political class is destroying this country, quite frankly. I think that's one thing. So you have him and Ben Carson, two people who are not professional
yeah,
politicians.
Yeah, these are outsiders. Why are they polling so high?
Well, that's one reason. They're outsiders. They're plain-spoken. Mm. People think they say what they really think. Mm-hmm. The second thing I think about Trump, Raymond, is that he has grabbed onto some issues that Americans care passionately about, mm. particularly the illegal immigration issue and the trade issue.
Yeah.
They're very intimately tied into the way people think things are going in their lives, their ability of their kids to make a living, particularly people who aren't college educated and can go into the you know upper middle class, professional class. And he's just speaking about it very plainly in a way that I think relates to a lot of people in this country. Mm.
It's amazing what's happening and how long he's maintained what many said initially was a boomlet.
Right.
Looks like much more than a boomlet.
Right.
I want to play this for you. This is Donald Trump at a press conference in Iowa this past Tuesday. He is essentially ignoring a Univision journalist, Jorge Ramos, who just stands up in the middle of the press conference and is sending questions forward to the podium. Watch this exchange.
Trump has a question on immigration here in New York. Okay, who's next? Yeah, please. Excuse me, sit down. You weren't called. Sit down. Sit down. Sit down. Go ahead. No, you don't. You haven't been called. Go back to Univision. You weren't called.
Terry Jeffrey and exchanges like it.
I think it actually helps Trump. You know, Newt Gingrich did it last time around, by the way. I mean, after Congress, the other people that the American people aren't real thrilled about is the liberal establishment press. This guy clearly, with Univision, is part of the liberal establishment press. Trump's getting back in his face. I think people perceive that the establishment press in this country has too much power. They may have too much power over who gets elected to office. They try and eliminate people. They have litmus tests for certain issues that they'd like to say you cannot run for president or be president of the United States if you have these beliefs. So I think people actually appreciate a guy running for office who doesn't care about that and is ready to get back in their
face. I mean, similarly, we keep hearing, oh, it's the anger of the people. It is their upsetment against the establishment and the media because they feel, the average voter, I think, feels as if they have no voice. They can't respond to these institutions. Here you've got a guy with the money and the moxie and the platform to respond. And, you know, I keep talking to my friends in the political class here, consultants wringing their hands saying, "What? When does this thing flame out?"
Well, it is truly a unique phenomenon. And the fact that Trump has the money to be able to fund his own campaign, I think, changes the dynamics a little bit. Momentum is tremendously important in presidential campaigns. So the other candidates have to look, where can they get the momentum to overcome Trump? And there's only a few places. And unfortunately, from my point of view, the process has been set up in a way that less well-funded candidates who may have strong appeal to people in terms of their values with folks on the grassroots don't have as much of a chance simply because of the way it's structured.
Yeah. Well, I also think there's something here, and these consultants keep saying, how can he get away with this? If my candidate said that or if this candidate said that, they'd be dead. This would be the end of them. I say, look, this is the reality show insulation around Donald Trump. The character that people see on television, on The Apprentice, and all these years, he was always a blunt-talking, even nasty guy around the edges. Yeah. We expect that from the character. So when he does these things, people applaud rather than grimace and run away. It's an amazing confluence of personality and a political moment coming together.
Yeah, there's no doubt about it. But I will say I think there's a question of whether that is the demeanor people ultimately want in a president of the United States.
That's a big question. Big question. Trump earlier this week said the Bible was his favorite book. He then was asked by Bloomberg Television to name one or two of your most favorite Bible verses. Here's what he had to say.
When I talk about the Bible, it's very personal, so I don't want to get into verses.
There's no verse that means a lot to you that you think about or cite?
The Bible means a lot to me, but I don't want to get into specifics.
Does that hurt him, not getting into specifics, even though he is flying high with evangelicals right now?
Yes, absolutely. He should have, what are his favorite passages? I'd say one that people in politics ought to pay attention to is the commandment, thou shalt not kill. Because one of the things we see in American life today is the countenance of our political elite and the legalized killing of innocent human beings. And Donald Trump says he's pro-life. And he ought to promote that commandment in his political campaign if he's pro-life.
This is a good segue to a story that you authored called U.S. Government Made Humanized Mice with Tissue from Babies 17 to 22 Weeks Gestational Age. What is this about? This is the National Institutes of Health. Why are we creating humanized mice to begin with?
This is a very horrible thing, Raymond, and this is something that the American people need to know about and Congress needs to deal with. What I wrote about here said our government, the U.S. government, through the National Institutes of Health, which is a part of the federal government, itself was conducting research where they created mice that had human immune systems, and to do that, they had to get the livers and thymuses from unborn babies at 17 to 22 weeks of gestational age. They were making 40 of these mice from a single donor baby, which basically meant they needed an intact liver, which they described in their article, and a thymus. Thymus is a very fragile organ in an unborn child. So these government researchers who work for the government, who are paid by the government, who are doing quote-unquote intramural government research, were creating these mice at an NIH laboratory in Montana. They say, now I found out about it by reading medical journal articles where they wrote about it. They actually wrote an article in April of 2014, last year, these government researchers, where they described how they made this mouse, and I quote their journal article in my piece, and I also link to it. People can read it themselves. I mean, this is unbelievable stuff, but it actually is happening, where they described how they created these mice using human fetal thymuses and livers. They basically created this surgical assembly line to create these mice.
Terry Jeffrey, yeah. What is the end game? What are they seeking? What is this experimentation and research about?
This particular type of mouse, Raymond, and the reason that our government is consuming human fetal livers and thymuses is meant to create a human immune system in a mouse. And the reason they want to create the human immune system in the mouse is so they can infect the mouse with HIV, the human immunodeficiency virus, which won't infect the blood cells of a different species. Mm-hmm. So they need it. They want a laboratory animal they can infect with HIV, the virus that causes AIDS, and then they can experiment and do research on cures, therapies, and vaccines, and so forth for AIDS. Mm-hmm. The truth is they've been doing this since the late 1980s. They've been making versions of this mouse. The government, through the NIH, has funded researchers outside of the government who use these mice. In this particular instance where I'm talking about, it was the government itself. Raymond, I posed 30 questions to the National Institutes of Health. I put them in writing. People can read my story. They can look at the questions that are posted. The NIH tried to claim they couldn't answer the majority of my questions because they were related to medical services for abortion, and that they got these through an intermediary. The intermediary is Advanced Biosciences Resources, based in Alameda, California. Mm-hmm. I sent the same questions to Advanced Biosciences Resources. I talked to them on the phone. They refused to comment. So the government's provider, Advanced Biosciences Resources of Alameda, California, and the NIH, which conducted this research, would not answer any of my questions. But I asked them, for example.
And what do you think is happening here? Do you think that you believe they're creating a trade, essentially?
Yes.
A marketplace for the horrible body parts we've been seeing coming out of Planned Parenthood.
Well, there's absolutely no doubt that here, in this particular research that the government conducted that I wrote about, the government was the end recipient of these late-term organs taken out of babies. Mm. All right?
But there's now, the government says this is perfectly legal, Terry. Well, in their statement to you, they say this
John
is perfectly
Boehner,
legal.
Well, John Boehner, Mitch McConnell, I got something for you. They say it's legal. Should it be legal next month? Obviously, in my view, and in the view, I think, of anybody who has an understanding of the value of human life, abortion itself ought to be illegal from the moment of conception. But what's happening here is a baby is reaching the 17th, 20th, 22nd week of gestation. Some other research, I'll tell you, it's beyond that. The baby is being aborted, and the tissue is being cut out. And it's in this case, in government-conducted research, they're transplanting that tissue into mice. But the bottom line is this, and I've written about this before, and I'm going to write about it some more, but with the government-funded research using mice that are transplanted with tissue taken from human babies in late gestation, and the government's direct research, the government is creating a demand for fetal tissue. Mm-hmm. And, this is, it'd be one thing if it was a baby that died from a miscarriage or a stillbirth and the parents said, you know what, we want to contribute. These babies are aborted. And I would go so far as to say if the government is going to engage in this research and they think that the researchers they fund and the research that they're doing inside the NIH needs late-term organs from late-term aborted babies, then our government has an interest in the late-term abortion of a human life in the mother's womb. Mm. They have an interest in it. Mm. So I tell you what, I challenge John Boehner, I challenge Mitch McConnell, make it illegal for anybody to harvest organs out of an aborted baby, period. It's not, Planned Parenthood should be defunded, but it should be beyond that. Not a single baby that's aborted should have their tissue harvested to go into some government-funded research or any other kind of research, even if it's funded by the private sector.
Let me shift gears in our final moments here. We are seeing in the same Quinnipiac poll, Joe Biden is outpolling Trump, Hillary Clinton, everybody in this field, and there's a lot of rumor in this town that he's going to jump into this race, given Hillary Clinton's problems with her server and everything else, and the terrible public impression of her. The words most associated with Hillary Clinton, according to Quinnipiac, liar, dishonesty, untrustworthy. Those are the top three words. Do you think Biden gets in?
Yes, and here's something the Democrats really have to think about. As you know, there are requirements for getting on the ballots in all these different states. Some states like New York and Chicago, Illinois, have much more onerous requirements for getting on the ballot. So they can't wait around to see if something's going to happen and develop in terms of these stories about Hillary Clinton that is devastating to her campaign in February. Mm-hmm. If they want another candidate of the stature that they think will be a formidable, viable candidate next year, they got to get someone in now.
Terry Jeffrey, thank you for being
here. Thank you, Raymond.
You can follow all of Terry's columns at cnsnews.com. Now, don't miss next week. We will be joined by Rachel Renee Russell. She is the best-selling author of The Dork Diaries, and we've got some other surprises for you. Until next week, the show continues on Facebook and Twitter. Like me on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter. The links are at RaymondArroyo.com. And if you'd like me to visit your group, school, or store during my Will Wilder and the Relic of Perilous Falls book tour this March, email me at Raymond@RaymondArroyo.com. Put Will Wilder in the subject line and send me your contact info, and we'll be in touch. Until next time, we'll be scouting the world over for all that is seen and unseen. On behalf of the staff and crew of EWTN News, thanks for watching. I'm Raymond Arroyo from Washington, D.C. Bye now.